bem. Tenho o prazer de apresentar a Britta Weiffen, que vai falar hoje sobre a Regional Organization Support Democracy, uma comparação entre a América e a América Latina. Esse tema também é um dos temas de um livro que ela escreveu junto com Então, esse livro saiu há um ano, chama 21st Century Democracy Promotion in the Americas, Standing Up for Equality. E ela nos enviou como base para a sua apresentação do primeiro capítulo. Rapidamente, falando um pouco sobre a Britta, ela fez a formação acadêmica dela em parte na Alemanha, primeiro em Bonn, fez mestrado, depois lecionou em Köln, Tübingen e Konstanz, mais tempo em Konstanz, e teve também um scholarship, uma bolsa no último ano, trabalhando no IRI. A partir do mês passado, é a professora na Câtedra Martius, que fica, na verdade, ela está instalada no Centro de Cultura,
Casa de Cultura
Japonesa. Mas, como ela está vinculada, na verdade, à FEFEDESH e oferecerá também, mas ela vai poder falar um pouco sobre isso, disciplina daqui ou no mínimo. Bom, os temas dela são democratização, processo de paz, integração regional. Não vou me deter muito mais com isso e passar a palavra para ela. Muito obrigado.
Antes de prepararmos uma mini surpresa aqui, o meu nome é Sven Corsilius, eu sou professor visitante também no DAD, na Faculdade de Direito, agora faz 4 anos. Eu trabalhei muito bem com o Rainer Schmidt, que já foi mencionado aqui, foi na Câtedra Martius durante 6 anos da sua vida. Eu conheci a Britta, acho que foi em maio que a gente teve o primeiro contato e em maio ela estava ainda no IRI, ainda não estava na posse da Câtedra Martius, já começou a organizar um evento junto comigo, e essas coisas também são para agradecer essa, para mim, da minha perspectiva, um ótimo início de uma ótima cooperação. O nosso evento vão ser as jornadas europeias, então 3 dias de palestras sobre assuntos sobre a reunificação europeia, unificação, integração europeia. Anteontem dei uma palestra sobre a unificação alemã. Integração europeia. Então vai ser de 9 a 11 de novembro na Faculdade de Direito. Já abuso a situação para fazer uma propaganda para o nosso evento. Queria dar muitos cordiais bem-vindos aqui à Britta. E espero que trabalhamos com USP, nossa USP.
Obrigada.
Boa palestra.
Obrigada. Agora, ainda não me sinto muito motivada, já que já recebi o presente.
Né? Já. Nossa, eu sei que muitas pessoas têm que ir mais cedo, que ia fazer a sol, todo mundo presente.
Ok, boa tarde a todos.
Boa tarde.
Eu sou a Britta Weiffen, eu sou professora ainda não decidi se vou fazer a palestra no pé ou sentada. Bem, meu português é mais ou menos bem para a conversa diária, mas ainda não fiz uma palestra desse tamanho em português. Eu empecei essa semana com fazer alguns comentários no IRI, no seminário de centro de pós-graduação lá, que estavam como 20 minutos, 15 deles em português, 5 em espanhol, mais ou menos. ou em português, talvez, tudo, não sei. Mas agora depois vou trocar para inglês, porque ainda me sinto muito mais tranquila. mas a gente depois pode fazer perguntas em português se quiser, ou também em espanhol, está bem. Okay, so I will switch to English now, and again I have to apologize for not being able yet to speak completely perfect Portuguese even after a year of being here. I think that's just because of the courtesy of Brazilians, because many of them speak English to me, and I also have a lot of friends or colleagues who are Spanish speakers or German speakers, so now my presentation disappeared. So that I didn't really have that much opportunity, and so I'm hoping to be able in the future to engage with as many as you as possible on topics of research and mutual interest, so that I can not only learn from you and you maybe something from me, but also improve my Portuguese. So that's the agenda, the unofficial agenda for the next 2 years. And that makes me nervous here. It doesn't work anymore. Okay. I'm sorry. Yes, the computer is a bit dated already. It sometimes takes a while. So I'm just going to start with talking about my new position now, the Câtedra Martius. Sometimes people confuse it and call it Câtedra Staden or Martius-Staden, because I think that's because there's also an institute, Martius-Staden, here in São Paulo, which, however, has now no institutional connection to the chair of the Câtedra, even though they also work on issues of Brazilian-German relations. So I arrived here, well, I didn't already arrive here 1 year ago, and now I took up the new post. My profile, as you will see, hopefully see in a minute, because I also abused the opportunity of talking to you to introduce myself a bit to you, even though you've heard a little bit already. To talk briefly about my fields of research, because that also kind of nicely situates the topic of the talk today. So my profile is quite different from the profile of Rainer Schmidt, who was very much focused on political theory, even though we do have some overlap in the area of democracy research. He bought a lot of books, which are now in my new office, and I found there is a lot of stuff that I'm very interested in as well. So there is some overlap, but apart from that, I think I'll do different topics. So I've been working a little bit at the intersection between international relations and comparative politics. My plans for the time in the Câtedra, which for now is for 2 years and then might be extended for up to 5 years, is to continue working on these topics and to try to include as many comparative perspectives, Europe, Latin America, or Brazil, Germany, or even going beyond that, looking at Europe, Latin America, and other world regions in comparison as possible. And so I hope that I could also make a contribution due to the fact that, international relations, of course, there is the IRI, the International Relations Institute, but my impression is it has a very strong political economy focus. So other topics of international relations, like international organizations, for instance, regionalism, are not very well represented there. These are topics that I'm working on. So I hope to be able also to fill a bit of a gap between IRI maybe and DCP with what I'm doing in my research and teaching. Right now I'm teaching a course at IRI, which is due to the fact that I was still there when they asked me about what they organized the new semester, and that it wasn't clear yet at the time that I'm going to be here from August onwards. But from next semester onwards, I'm also going to teach at DCP. And I hope also to be able to organize a lot of interesting seminars. You've heard already about the Jornadas Europeas that are forthcoming in November, We also are going to organize a workshop with Detlef Nolte in November from the German Institute of Global and Area Studies. He's the director of the Latin American Institute there, and will be here in Sao Paulo for a couple of days. We have not yet agreed upon a topic for the presentation, but it will be something, I guess, with related to regionalism or Latin America. So I'm still discussing it with Rafael and some other people, and we'll publicize it as soon as possible. Well, what's going on here? Doesn't really look good. Okay, so I'm very sorry for this slight delays, but we're ready to go now, I hope. I hope the computer is as well. So today what I'm going to talk about today is a topic that, as Bruno already mentioned, has been a topic of a book that has come out about a year ago already. But I'm actually not going to present the book, because I've done that several times and I'm getting bored of it and I want to move forward. So the idea is to take the book as a starting point and to show you a bit what I'm doing now, currently building on the book. Maybe to situate the book a bit, like the history of the book very briefly, how it came along. So here you can see that, as I already mentioned, my research interests are situated in between what you would commonly locate in the field of comparative politics and topics of international relations and peace and conflict research. So my dissertation, for instance, has been on determinants of democracy. At the same time, during my PhD time, I've worked on a project that dealt with regional security organizations and how they contribute to the mitigation of interstate rivalries. So there were these two things at the same time. And then in between there is this kind of intersection topic of democratization or democracy promotion or protection of democracy by regional organizations, which is a synthesis of both of the other topics that I have been working on before. And so I kind of started already during the final phase of my dissertation reading on this topic on what various regional organizations have been doing in the area of the management of political crisis within countries, responses to coups, responses to coup threats, or constitutional crisis. As you can see, it is a topic that is really situated at the intersection between international relations and comparative politics. Because on the one hand, questions like the development of democracy, stabilization, consolidation of democracy are relevant here. The definition of what is a political crisis, or crisis of democracy maybe, in these countries. In Latin America or in other world regions or even in Europe. And then on the other hand, the question of conflict management, crisis management by regional organizations and the instruments and mechanisms that they use to respond to crises in their member states. So this is very much how this topic of the book emerged. And as has been said before, the book was published last year and focuses on, even though the title doesn't say so, focuses on the Organization of American States and how it has managed democratic crisis in Latin America, mainly looking at the time period after the adoption of the Inter-American Democratic Charter in 2001. So So the book, though, is part of the Global Institution series by Rowland, very much a state-of-the-art overview. But there are a number of kind of embryonic ideas in it that I'm now developing further, both conceptual and comparative ideas. And what I'm going to talk about today is trying to make a comparison between Latin America, which is the focus of this book, and Europe, which is now supposed to be my focus of research, as I'm now the chair for German and European studies, and I think it's quite interesting to make this comparison. So I'm currently working on a paper that looks at regional democracy clauses not only in Latin America, but also in other world regions. So not only in Europe. And actually, I think Latin America and Europe is, as you will see, a bit difficult, the comparison, because the logic of what is being done about democracy is quite distinct. And it's actually, well, it would be easier to compare only non-European regional organizations, because their logic of defending, protecting democracy is more similar than what the European Union especially is doing. So this is the agenda for today. I'm going to give a brief overview of what is at stake when talking about regional organizations and domestic politics, and particularly the development of democracy. Talk a little bit about the challenges of comparing regions in general, or regional organizations in particular. We'll then mostly focus on, well, trying to develop a comparative framework of how to compare these regional organizations, and then apply that to European and Latin American organizations, in particular the EU and the Organization of American States, and draw some conclusions in the end, obviously, in preliminary. Actually, it's an interesting trend to see that many organizations, regional organizations, have adopted norms and standards and instruments to promote and protect norms in their member states. So there have been a number of publications on this. For instance, John Peavyhouse's book called Democratization from Above, which was published about 10 years, or exactly 10 years ago. Where he explored the capacity of regional organizations to contribute to democratic transitions and also to democratic consolidations. Explored largely by which mechanisms these regional organizations do that, and also found out that more densely democratic regional organizations are more likely to be successful in this endeavor of fostering democracy. Then there is Daniela Donnell's work, who mainly focuses on the role of regional actors in response to electoral misconduct, so a more restricted focus on a specific aspect of elections and the performance and the procedures of elections. And then there are more recent books, two new books that come out this year. One looks in particular at regional integration organizations, so at organizations that focus on economic integration, and how they, for mainly economic reasons, for wanting to keep stability in the country, have been conducive to maintaining democratic stability and adopting so-called democracy clauses. And then there has been another publication where this graph is taken from, where not only democracy but also norms of governance, standards as they call it, in the area of human rights, in the area of good governance and the rule of law are examined. Here you can see this trend that regional organizations have increasingly over time adopted mechanisms like this and have adopted norms in the field of democracy, human rights, and so forth. It seems to be a trend, but it's not like many scholars would expect, or there is still a very implicit understanding in many of the works who look at regional organizations and the adoption of norms and promotion of norms, that there is such a thing like a global model that is then adopted more or less unchanged by all kinds of regional organizations all over the world. And this study has found out that this is not really the case, that there are regional variations. Well, even though there is this general trend that the exact contents of what it means to have a human rights norm or to have a democratic norm in place can vary quite a bit. And this can actually also be a problem for research. Just very briefly, what are the driving forces? Why do these regional organizations want to do that? I'm not going to talk about that very much in detail today, just to give you a bit of an overview of the potential explanatory factors that have also been discussed in this book by Wörzl and von Hüllen, from which the previous graph is taken. So there is this logic of locking in reforms, which is very much applying to young democracies that try to commit internationally to democratic standards in order to consolidate or support the consolidation of democracy at home. There's also the idea of curbing negative externalities, for instance, when it's about conflict and large human rights violations in countries, that adopting human rights standards might help to mitigate human rights violations and also to curb refugee flows across borders and other externalities. Preserving political stability, obviously, is an interest of many states, or in some cases also fending off external interference. So this is very much a motivation for African countries to found their own norms, their own mechanisms, in order to fend off interference from former colonial powers. So here you have on the right, left-hand side, you have more like the rational instrumental logic factors. Then, of course, some people argue there's also normative logics that that it lends states international legitimacy to adopt certain norms, and that they, of course, might also be convinced that these are good norms that they want to subscribe to. And in terms of supply factors, so what fosters from the supply side, what fosters the development of these norms? A regional hegemon could play a role that is willing to bear some of the costs of such a project, or donors or external powers. There could also be functional reference models, or like regional organization where these norms are obviously bringing some benefits, and therefore other regional organizations hope that by adopting such norms they could reap such benefits as well. On the more normative side, there is this idea of a global script, like a global trend towards adopting human rights norms or democratic norms, and that many countries would then follow this path. Now, so the studies, or the of course, the aim of looking at regional organizations and their mechanisms to compare democracy is to say something about, well, why is this happening? Then also to say something about the effects at some point. The problem, however, is that many of the studies who compare many cases lump together many different things. So as I said before, if you just lump all the countries or all the regional organizations that do have some sort of democratic norms together in one category, you might capture very different things. You might capture a mere rhetoric commitment to democracy, and you might also capture enforcement mechanisms that are in place and that these organizations have actually used to defend democracy in their member states. So there might be a wide variance. And actually, I think even though it's, of course, some extent of generalization is unavoidable if you want to make large M comparisons, if you want to compare a certain number of cases. However, I have the feeling that many of the works that have so far tried to do so do not really sufficiently point their readers to the fact that these organizations or these organizational mechanisms that they capture in their data sets or in their lists of democratic norms, democracy clauses, however they might be called, might be very different things. For instance, there's a recent book on economic integration and democratic conditionality codes as democracy clauses mere commitment to democracy, like in Central Asian states, for instance, or former Soviet Union states, like a regional organization named UAM, which I think is Ukraine and Georgia and some others. And at the same time, in the same category, are those organizations that do have institutionalized measures to respond to coups and coup attempts and have actually used them already. So it's a wide range of issues that are captured here. So we need to be more sensitive towards the differences and distinctions between what it might mean to have a democracy clause. So there might be a difference between a mere prescription of norms and the existence of norm enforcement mechanisms. There might also be a difference regarding whether the organization is focusing on supporting democratic transitions or whether it's more focusing on supporting the phase of democratic consolidation in the member states. This could be differentiated also, or there's a lot of terms around, and many of them are not clearly defined. For instance, promotion, protection, and defense of democracy are often used interchangeably, and it's often not clearly defined what they mean and how they are distinct from each other. There are also these variants of inward and outward directed democracy protection, so inward meaning towards the member states of the regional organization, and outward towards states that are not or not yet members. In some cases, they do have an accession perspective, in some cases this is not so. Reactive versus preventive measures is also an important differentiation. And then of course you can differentiate between the strength of these mechanisms, weak, moderate or strong mechanisms, or well, more declaratory mechanisms, cooperation, diplomatic facilitation for instance, and confrontational measures such as sanctions or suspension of the member state from the activities of the organization. As there is such a lot of indeterminacy in the terminology, what it means to have democracy protection mechanisms in place, I've tried to systematize that a little bit. I think the basis for all kinds of these mechanisms would be to have a democratic norm. And there's also some disagreement in the literature, by the way, on what a democracy clause means. Some say it means democratic conditionality, so the requirement of being a democracy to become or be a member of an organization. Others say democracy clause means having sanctions mechanisms in the organization. So there's a wide divergence even on this. And I would say that this kind of is the fundament or the basis for any democracy protection mechanism that you might have, to have some sort of normative agreement formal adherence to democratic norms in the policy program of the organization. And this could be subdivided into endorsement, which can be restricted to mere rhetoric adherence to democracy. Commitment, which is a bit more forceful, a bit more maybe, for instance, then the goal of promoting democracy moves from very general, the preamble, for instance, to the enumeration of the goals of the organization, so it's elevated to be more important. And then the membership requirements, so formally recommitting the members to be democracies before they can become a member of the organization or to be able to remain a member of the organization, would be even stronger. And then further on, to look at institutionalized mechanisms, we would have to distinguish between different modes of democracy promotion or of support to democracy in order to be able to capture more clearly what we are talking about. And here I would say we can distinguish between these three different modes: promotion, protection, and defense of democracy. They do overlap to some extent, but you can tie each of them to a specific phase of the democratization process. So democracy promotion would be measures to trigger democratic transitions and to support democratic transitions. whereas the protection of democracy would set in once a country is already at least a formal democracy, and now it is about consolidating democratic norms and rules and making them, well, getting them rooted in the society and the country. And then the defense of democracy sets in when it is about defending the achieved norms and mechanisms or the achieved level of democracy against any type of backsliding, against coup attempts, for instance, or other unconstitutional threats or unconstitutional changes of government more generally. So we can tie promotion to transition, protection to positive consolidation, and defense to negative consolidation, and then distinguish accordingly the institutionalized mechanisms of organizations, which can also be called operational activities, so to distinguish them from the policy program or this one paper, what do these organizations actually do to implement these norms? And do they create institutionalized mechanisms? And when we talk about democracy promotion, this is kind of a list which is quite well known, which many people have written about, kind of different types of democracy promotion with a varying level of coerciveness, you could say, starting with persuasion, socialization, capacity building, which also often is called democracy assistance, negative and positive incentives or conditionalities, and then coercion by sanctions or, in the most extreme case, by military intervention. Which, by the way, is often in the public perception associated with democracy promotion, of course, after Iraq and Afghanistan and the US activities in the Middle East. Many people have this association of thinking about democracy promotion as military intervention. But, of course, this is only one variant, and the number of cases where military intervention has been explicitly used to promote democracy is quite limited. So you shouldn't have this kind of intellectual backlash against democracy promotion in general, because the range of mechanisms is much more multifaceted than just military intervention. So we can make this distinction between policy program and operational activities. When we look at operational activities, I'm not going to do that now, but we can then also look at the fact that they are in place and the fact that they are actually used, which is also not necessarily the same. You can have these provisions in place and then they are never actually applied, and we will see that later also, that there are examples for that. Now, when we look at when we distinguish the promotion of democracy from the protection and defense of democracy, then operational activities would be a bit different. They would still be on this basis, they would still rest on this basis of democratic norms. But we would have different institutionalized mechanisms for the protection of democracy. A good example, or the most frequent and most well-known example, would be election observation under a bigger rubric of monitoring. Some organizations also have something like political analysis, which would be an observation or monitoring of what is going on in the country beyond the election date, which is something that many representatives of regional organizations name as very desirable, yet it does not exist in many organizations. In the Organization of American States, for instance, there was an informal mechanism which where experts were monitoring countries that were considered to be at risk. However, they did not publicly disclose which countries these were, and the results that were drafted, the reports that were drafted in the end, were only for internal consumption in the General Secretariat. So it was a quite informal mechanism, but they were trying to build such a thing. Let's see whether this will continue under the new Secretary General of the OAS. That is to be seen, because of course the personnel has changed now, and maybe the priorities are different. Secondly, when we look at the defense of democracy and institutionalized mechanisms there, there are various enforcement mechanisms. On the one hand, softer mechanisms such as facilitation or generally diplomatic mechanisms such as mediation or negotiations or the good offices of the Secretary General, and then harder mechanisms such as sanctions. One example or one measure very frequently employed by regional organizations is the suspension of members from, well, from the organization in total or from specific activities or specific benefits of the regional organization membership. Now, I hope that this is not too abstract and boring. If you have never thought about regional organizations before, it might well be. So let's get a bit more concrete and try to apply these categories to Europe and Latin America. As I said before, it's a quite tricky comparison, but at the same time, it's also an interesting comparison because it shows you exactly what I have said at the beginning, that promotion, protection, support of democracy by regional organizations might follow completely different logics, and that it might be problematic to lump it all together. And it is also problematic that to assume that all these kinds of norms, like the promotion of democracy, emerge from the European Union and then are copied from the European model by other regional organizations, because that's just not really true, depending on what type of institutionalized mechanisms of democracy support we look at. Now, let's look at the European Union as the most well-known regional organization from Europe. These days, not considered that successful anymore, but that's not our topic today. So the European Union has been considered, or has always been, at the forefront of promoting democracy and aspirants members. So accession countries that are interested in becoming members of the European Union. So that, I think that is the most well-known logic of democracy promotion by the European Union, what it is famous for. And I think that's also the version of the variant of democracy promotion by the EU that has been mostly discussed in the literature and the majority of publications has been written about. However, there are other variants as well. The EU started already implementing or including the goal of promoting democracy and human rights in its development policies already in the 1980s, I think. So it was directed towards extra-regional countries, developing countries in Asia, Africa, Latin America, where the EU had some connections or was fostering some projects, and often they did have some implicit or explicit requirements to implement reforms, to improve the rule of law, or to stick to democratic standards. And this can happen directly by, for instance, by support for civil society in the course of democratization processes, for instance, or indirectly by support for socioeconomic development, while following a little bit the modernization approaches, assumptions that socioeconomic development would at some point be conducive to democratization or at least support democratization that is already ongoing. So so here we have these logics of linkage, of trying to promote democracy or support democratization processes outside the region. Then there is the logic of leverage, which is the one that I've mentioned before. This logic of conditionality, of trying to set conditions for countries that are interested in becoming members of the European Union and that do also have a realistic perspective of becoming a member of the European Union. So the European Union has put together a very complex system of requirements, which I'll explain in a little bit more detail in a minute. Which is considered to be quite successful with respect to the countries that over time, since the 1980s basically, have joined the European Union. And then the most recent approach is what is often called governance approach, which is directed to neighboring countries that do not really have a perspective of accession, such as the Northern African countries, for instance. or former Soviet Union member states like Georgia, Azerbaijan, and so on. And here there is kind of a new strategy where the European Union has tried to kind of promote, not directly, but very indirectly, its norms and values by establishing transgovernmental relations, by establishing, for instance, bureaucratic relations between EU bureaucrats and the bureaucrats of these states. To create cooperation in topics that on first sight have nothing to do with democracy, but in, for instance, organizing seminars on, environmental governance, for instance, bringing together people from different countries, and by that very indirectly bringing on the table this issue of what is good governance, and that corruption is not good, and all these kind of promotion of values which is supposed to go on here. So that's right now the fancy topic of EU scholars that write about democracy promotion, to look at how this membership or this neighborhood promotion of democracy in the neighborhood is taking place very indirectly and by very, very subtle mechanisms. Well, as for the most famous mechanism, let's leave that for now. Contents of the new conditionality. So there's the general proposition that the government of a state that becomes a member of the European Union should share the values of the European Union. And many countries were attracted to the European Union and were hoping to become a member and to benefit from the advantages of European integration, of the European economic model, of the support to poorer regions, for instance, and all the other activities that are going on in the European Union. And therefore, the idea was to invite countries to become members, but to set some requirements that this government would have to fulfill in order to step by step become a member state. And these are basically three big steps that they had to do. One is legislative alignment, which means kind of adopting all the EU legislation, so-called acquis communautaire, and or bring their laws in line with the body of European Union law. Second, economic criteria, that there is homogeneity between the potential member country and the current member countries, and that the new member country and potential member country is able to cope with the competitive pressure in the EU. And most relevant for us now, political criteria, so that the member states or the new member states should subscribe to the principles of Article 2 of the EU Treaty. This is really the sine qua non, the non-negotiable condition for membership. And here you can read some the extracts of the European Union. The Union is founded on the values of respect for human dignity, freedom, democracy, equality, the rule of law, and respect for human rights, including the rights of persons belonging to minorities. These values are common to member states in a society in which pluralism, non-discrimination, tolerance, justice, solidarity, and equality between women and men prevail. And then in Article 49 it says that any European states which respects these values referred to in Article 2 and is committed to promoting them may apply to become a member of the Union. So the countries have to fulfill these conditions first and to share these values in order to be admitted. So as I said, this is the most well-known mechanism, this conditionality, this step-by-step accession process that many countries, ranging from Spain to Croatia, most recently, have been going through. However, the European Union does also have mechanisms for the defense of democracy. However, they were not the pioneers in that. Actually, the Organization of American States was the, one could say, the pioneer in this field, and much earlier adopted mechanisms to defend democracy in their member states. but this only became a topic in the European Union in the course of the accession of the Eastern European member state, where apparently some of the old member states were fearing that there could be democratic regressions, democratic crises and instability, maybe too much influence of communist, former communist parties in these new member states, and therefore they decided that the EU should also have a provision to react to democratic crises or democratic setbacks in their member states. And this is what we today find in Article 7 of the Treaty of the European Union, which was first implemented in the Amsterdam Treaty in 1997, a reactive mechanism that, well, that said that in the case of a serious and persistent breach of the values referred to in Article 2, which we've seen before, there could be a suspension of certain rights of member states. And then later on, this was broadened somewhat in the Treaty of Nice in 2001, and expanded to include some preventive mechanisms, so that even when there is a clear risk of a serious breach, that there could be some action from the side of the European Union in order to prevent a further erosion of the Article 2 values. Now, this expansion is very much due to one of the cases, or one of the most prominent cases, where this use of Article 7 was debated, and this is the case of Austria in 1999-2000, where in the end, after some back and forth, the right-wing populist Freedom Party became part of the government. And here the European Union discussed very much whether this Article 7, whether this should be considered a serious breach of the values of the Union. And ultimately they decided that they could not really resolve that it was, and but still they adopted some sanctions. But this led to the discussion, to the expansion of Article 7, to, well, from the serious breach to the mere risks of serious breach. And that is, I think, what they considered this accession of power of the right-wing party to be. There have been a few further cases where the application of Article 7 has been discussed, including the expulsion of Romani Roma people in 2010 from France back to Bulgaria and Romania. Hungary is still an ongoing issue, where after the election of the Fidesz government in 2010, there was a constitutional change in 2011, which led to quite some degradations of the rule of law, of press freedom, of equality provisions. And so many people say there is an erosion of democratic values in Hungary according to what the government is doing. But yet there was not really the resolve to apply Article 7 so far. And another case in Romania, where there was a constitutional and political confrontation between the president and the prime minister about a number of issues, which led to a constitutional crisis in the country. So we can see that there are many contexts where this application of this article has been discussed, but so far it has never been really invoked, so no country has ever been suspended from EU activities in accordance with these provisions. Now, what about the Americas? First of all, the Americas are much more pluralistic in terms of the democracy clauses that exist, so there are quite a number of them, and I don't have time to talk about all of them, but just to give you a quick overview, there is the Organization of American States that has adopted a democracy clause provision to react to unconstitutional changes of government already in 1991, which has then step by step been expanded. Mercosur also has such a provision. This happened in reaction to the coup threats in Paraguay in 1996. The Andean community followed suit and kind of adopted many of these issues as well, even though this ultimate protocol is not yet ratified. UNASUR has a protocol on commitment to democracy as well, which was ratified last year. And then CELAC also has a special declaration on the defense of democracy and the constitutional order. So basically most of the regional, older and newer regional organizations in the Americas do have some sort of democratic norm right now, which sort of underlines the thesis by Wurzel and others that this phenomenon is spread over the globe and that more and more regional organizations are adopting, well, governance standards or however you might want to call this. Looking in more detail at the Organization of American States, we can see that this democratic paradigm has grown over time. So already in the OAS Charter in 1948, you have an endorsement of democracy as the preferred system of rule in the member states. So there is democracy as a common norm. As we all know, however, there was no means to enforce it over time. There have been many phases of undemocratic rule since then in the region. And only in the course of the democratization process in the region in the 1980s, the OAS has resumed this topic and has made its democratic norms a bit more stronger. For instance, by reforming the charter several times, by the Cartagena Protocol, by establishing the Unit for the Promotion of Democracy, and also, well, the Santiago Commitment to Democracy and the renewal of the Inter-American System, which went along with the first mechanism of enforcement, which was Resolution 1080, which created the possibility that in reaction to some unconstitutional change of government, of course at that time what policymakers had in mind was a military coup mainly, that in reaction to that the organization should or the Secretary General should call a special session of the General Assembly of the organization and they should do something about it, even though it was not really very much specified what exactly the reactions should be. That was then done in the Washington Protocol in the following years, ratified 5 years later, where the possibility of suspending a member state from the organization was created. So a more concrete sanction mechanism was implemented. Then there were a lot of discussions over the 1990s whether this was enough or whether the organization should also have a means to react to not so clear violations of democratic rule or violations of democratic rule that came from democratically elected actors. Think, for instance, of the autogolpe in Peru in 1992 as one example where the threat to democracy did not emerge from the military, from non-democratically legitimized actors, but from an elected president. And so this is very much this discussion process from which, in the end, the Inter-American Democratic Charter emerged, which not only created the possibility or continued to offer the possibility to react to institutional interruptions of the democratic order, but also to so-called alterations of the democratic order. So here you have the principles of the Inter-American Democratic Charter, some of which are reaffirmations of what had been there before in the other documents, such as this anti-coup norm, which had been in existence before democracy as a membership requirement had been de facto there before as well with the Washington Protocol, the possibility of membership suspension as well, and also electoral invalidation, meaning the practice of electoral monitoring, electoral observation, and condemnation if there are any serious instances of electoral misconduct. On the innovative side, we have this new anti-authoritarian backsliding norm, unconstitutional alteration of the constitutional regime that seriously impairs the democratic order, is the somewhat complicated original formulation. The charter also establishes a right to democracy of the peoples in the Americas. It gives a quite extensive definition of representative democracy, which by the way includes and emphasizes the importance of participation of the people and of the citizens, which I think is quite important to mention because now there is a big contestation between representative democracy and participatory democracy, which often seems like if they were opposite to each other, which is not, I think, not really the case because they're both aspects are integral parts of what a democracy should mean. So this is more clearly specified here. Before, the OAS has always kind of said representative democracy but never really clearly defined what it means by it. And the new Inter-American Democratic Charter also created a possibility for graduate proportionate response. So there were different mechanisms. That the idea was to adapt these mechanisms to different situations. This looked like this. So this main chapter 4 of the Democratic Charter, which contains these provisions to defend democracy, has two more preventive clauses, which are Article 17 and 18, which enable the organization to respond to situations that present serious risks to the democratic order. In the case of Article 17, the state itself can ask for help. In the state of Article 18, it's the OAS, General Assembly, or the Permanent Council, or the Secretary General who takes the initiative. Something concretely can be done only with the consent of the member states, and this is a bit of a problem, as you can imagine. And Article 19 to 21 contain the reactive clauses, so when the crisis is already ongoing, it has already kind of escalated, that the organization can react. And here you have this differentiation then between unconstitutional alteration and unconstitutional interruption of the democratic order, and there's a stepwise process to determine which situation is really going on the ground and what the organization should do. And so the most extreme reaction then would be the suspension of the member state. This has so far only happened once, in the case of Honduras in 2009. So in our book we also explored these different cases, and this table just gives you a very condensed summary of how the Inter-American Democratic Charter has been used so far. So in contrast to the defense of democracy mechanism of the EU, it has in fact been used, even though some people say it could have been or should have been used much more than that, and there are still problems and reluctance of the political leaders to use it. Yet you can see that on several occasions some of these articles have been invoked, and if not, then in some cases there have been ad hoc facilitation mechanisms where there was no direct reference to the Inter-American Democratic Charter, but yet at the same time there was some sort of activity from the side of the OAS. Alright, to sum that up a little bit, so we can see when we compare the European Union and the OAS that they have a very different profile in terms of democracy promotion. And so that kind of also shows that it is problematic to talk in very general fashion about democracy promotion and just include everything, all kinds of activities, all kinds of democratic norms, all kinds of mechanisms, because their logics, the logics behind them might be very different. So the EU and what it is doing and has been doing has a great strength in pre-accession promotion of democracy. It has had its greatest successes in kind of socializing new and potential member states into the values, into the norms of the European Union. So it has a very established set of standards, instruments, norms, institutions, to promote democracy, well, to our countries that are not yet members, but want to become members. Whereas, on the other hand, the protection and defense of democracy in member states that are already member states is much less developed and, well, is lagging behind. There is Article 7, but it has been adopted much later than the other mechanisms and has so far not been used very much, or not at all, in fact. Looking at the OAS in contrast, we can see that this organization has its strength in post-accession protection and defense of democracy. And in fact, the OAS was the first organization around the world to adopt such a mechanism. So this Resolution 1080 that was adopted in 1991 was the first provision of regional organizations to adopt a mechanism to defend democracy, to do something from the part of a regional organization if there is anti-democratic actions in a member state. So I think that's quite remarkable, and that runs against the common wisdom of many EU scholars who always have this assumption that regional organizations outside Europe copy values from the European Union, or that, there is some sort of diffusion of norms and practices from the European Union to other world regions. There might well be, but here we can see when we look at this concrete mechanism for defense of democracy, this is not the case. That in fact we could even argue, well, I'm not sure, that would be an interesting topic of research, whether the EU, when it adopted this clause in 1997, has actually looked at the model of the US and whether this has in any way influenced the discussions in the European Union. Well, so the Organization of American States has a strength in the defense and protection of democracy, but is not very much developing mechanisms for the promotion of democracy. So what classic democracy promotion scholars understand as promotion of democracy, except of course for electoral assistance, where it is very active and has been active already since the 1980s. So they have different strengths. At the same time, when we focus on one particular issue area, when we focus on the defense of democracy only and leave aside the whole other ways that the European Union has used to promote democracy, we can still make a comparison and also detect some similarities. So there are some general problems and pitfalls of defending democracies, and these are just some very general examples that you can find in the European Union and in Latin America and also in other regional organizations. So the political will is very important, or political interests can be very important, or in some contexts also ideological bias can be very important. So that is very difficult to generally apply these norms, but states often act, or policymakers often act according to their personal interests and apply or not apply these norms. So it has been said, for instance, that many policymakers are reluctant to sanction a member state of a regional organization as long as they fear that at some point they might themselves be targeted for some undemocratic action. It has also been said in the case of the Austria issue in the European Union that here European leaders were willing to punish Austria because they were fearing the surge of populist right-wing movements in their own countries, and they want to send a clear signal to these movements that they would not let them get stronger. And you could say, okay, maybe they were just egoistic and fearing to lose their power or fearing to get less votes in the elections because of the rise of these parties and movements. Well, it's also often difficult to define when a crisis starts, or to set a threshold, a clear threshold, and to determine what is a crisis that warrants international reactions and what is just the usual political contestation in a country. And yet that's something that you can also see in both organizations. We have these unconstitutional alterations or the risks of a serious breach, as the EU formulates it. But there's not a list of clear-cut criteria when the situation is really there. So it's very much a matter of, of discussing, of interpretation, and also political negotiation. And so that, of course, also makes it difficult to really, decide at what point these mechanisms, if they are meant to use, would set in. And these are problems that we can find in both Europe and Latin America. A particularity of Latin America these days is what we have seen on one of the previous slides, that besides the OAS, a lot of other regional and sub-regional organizations have by now adopted democracy clauses. This kind of reflects a little bit the redefinition of the region, the emergence of South America as an own idea, represented by UNASUR. The idea of no longer having a strong US influence in the region and therefore forming organizations that explicitly exclude the United States and also Canada. And then, of course, as a consequence, these organizations also have created their own democracy clauses. And the question is whether this is problematic or beneficial for the strengthening of democracy in the region. On one hand, you could argue that these norms might be mutually reinforcing, might be good that all these different regional schemes have adopted these norms, that it is an expression of the general commitment of the region to democratic values. On the other hand, in practice, it could also create a problem as soon as several of these organizations come to different conclusions, whether a particular situation presents a democratic crisis or presents an alteration of the democratic order or not. And one example of this is the coup in, or so-called coup, there it already begins, you see, whether it is a coup or not is very contested. The contested impeachment procedure, I put it like this, in Paraguay in 2012, where UNASUR and MERCOSUR came to the conclusion that this was an unconstitutional interruption of the democratic order, and therefore they suspended Paraguay, whereas the OAS was much more cautious and said, hey, this is not a clear coup, there is something going on that was probably not legitimate, but we don't want to second guess the use of the constitutional provisions of a member state, and therefore we will do some behind the doors, maybe mediation, negotiation, and talks to all the parties involved, but there will not be an official declaration or invocation of the democratic charter. And this has not been very well received by many of the member states of UNASUR and MERCOSUR, who were of a different opinion. And here you can see that this is also, well, a potential problem, which is a particularity these days of Latin America. And by the way, also a topic that I'm currently working on, this phenomenon of overlapping democracy clauses. So, that's all from my side, and I hope you didn't fall asleep, and I'm looking forward to any comments and questions you may have. And as I said, please feel free to ask anything in Portuguese, Spanish, German if you want. Thank you very much.